Good evening, 236. 236 in your hymnals. Give him the glory. Let's all stand, shall we? Page 236. It was down at the feet of Jesus, oh, what a big, happy day, that my soul found peace in believing, and my sins were washed away. Let me tell thee, oh, the story of his grace, so full and free. Let my it was down at the feet of Jesus, where I found such perfect rest, where the light was flowing on my spirit, and my soul was fully blessed. Let me tell thee of the story of his grace so full and
I got a new toy.
I couldn't see it.
Well, if I'm asleep, that won't work.
I know. I'm going to get a whole bunch of them. Bill Straub, are you okay? No?
No.
He's here.
Amen.
Last thing we knew, you guys were racing to midpoint. And what did they say? No comment. We're still praying for it. We'll keep praying. Okay, keep praying for Bill and Joanne. Countless things. Boy, you guys just, you must be very, very spiritual for God to put all that on you because he knows you can take it. Really. Some of us don't go through anything. What's that tell you? What? Say it. Really?
To be used for his purpose.
That'll teach you, won't it? but you must have meant it because God's testing you. God always tests everything he uses. Wow. Pray for them real hard, would you? Countless people that, you know, people have been sick this year, but then we hear that they got sick again. I think Rex is on his fourth time. And some of you have just got it. It just, I don't know. Some of you deserve it. I, I was going to put on there, wake up, grow up, and throw up. But ready? Let's pray. Father, thank you for the opportunity to come to your house. We take very seriously what you do, what you want to do. And in the midst of it, we're able to rejoice because when we belong to you, we don't have to pretend. We don't have to try to keep up to any standard. But we do need to grow. And I pray that tonight will be an opportunity for us to grow in Christ. You said that we ought to grow. As newborn babes, you said, desire the sincere milk of the word that you may grow thereby. That's our desire. If it's not our desire, show us it ought to be, because it ought to be. Thank you that we can gather. Thank you for guests who are here. And I pray, of course, for Bill Strout, for Joanne, this time that they are trusting you through this test. Would you please, God, give them the strength they need? Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that we'll take tonight to dedicate a young child to you and to dedicate the parents and their purpose now with that child. Thank you, Lord, for the joy that's ours. Thank you that we can look forward as we sing, not just to staying here and singing, but someday being with you. Work tonight. Speak to our hearts. I pray and ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You can be seated.
Page 240, More Like the Master, 240.
More like the Master. Thank you.
Where's Fred? How'd the nursing home go?
It went well.
You have a good crowd?
A little crowd. I've been there for a while, so. And it was a new lady that's been there for about 4 months, so. But we had, I don't know, 6 or 7.
That's good. That's great. Who all went? Thanks, Chris. Good excuse. Yeah, it's my vertigo. It's always nice to have an excuse, a backup, so you're not accountable for everything. Chris, were you there? Okay. Just want to make sure. Who? Oh, yeah, what's his face? From New Carlisle. New Carlisle. Wednesday, the King's Kids is on spring break. If you're interested in that, it's all for the week. Easter plants, if you have a bulletin, you'll see several things. Easter plants, if you'd like to do, there's one afterglow left for the year that's open if you'd like to do one of those for the teens. That's the month of August. There's a youth activity, 2 weeks, 2 weeks, 3 weeks. The 9th, is that 2 weeks? 2 weeks. From today, our annual business meeting. Ladies are having their birthday dinner on the 11th. Easter Sunday on the 16th, we are having breakfast in the morning. Maybe we get Randy to come back. Remember that year you made all those pancakes? That was fun. I had pancakes for lunch. That okay? I had a guy, this guy comes up to me. He goes, hey, we're coming to church Sunday. I mean, I know him, but I've never asked him, never. And Amy and I sat down and looked at each other. I said, I guess he's coming to church. That's good. So we'll take that. Where's Jeremy hiding in the back? Jeremy, come out here for a minute. He needs to introduce everybody, doesn't he? Lisa doesn't want to do it. Go ahead, would you? Introduce everybody just so everybody knows who people are. Okay, who's over here? And? And? Okay. And? Who are they? I just want to see if he knew their name. My side here, her side over here. Glad you guys are sitting like it's a wedding. Oh, ushers come. At the end of the service, we're going to dedicate Aaron. His parents don't need it. They're perfect. But it's always them kids, isn't it? How many of you raise kids? How many of you would never do it again? It's great when they're little. Remember how hard you thought it was when they were little? I'll never make this. And then they get older. And then you want so bad for their kids to go bad. Or put them through, you know. Stephen never had that. His kids are pretty much perfect. But Micah would call me about little fire redhead Dominic. And, oh, what am I going to do, Dad? You want him? I don't want him. God gave him to you to show you what I went through. John Sheets, would you pray?
Lord, we're grateful for your goodness towards us. Lord, you bless, you give, you give, you give. Over and over, we thank you for it. May we be worthy. May we be more faithful in the future than we have in the past. And as usual, Lord, may the gift we give tonight reflect our love for you. For we ask us in Jesus' name, amen.
angels meet me there. 234. Let's all stand, shall we?
Give you before I cut loose, let me give you a little fatherly advice. I'm not that old, but I'm old enough. I want to help you. Remember when you were real young, those old guys would pull you aside and tell you something you needed to know? You didn't think they were right at the time, but as you got older, you realized they were right. I don't know what your Bible says, but my Bible says that a wise man increaseth in learning. So it ought to be a desire of yours to learn as much as you can. Let me just tell you this much. I think that you need to contemplate this. Don't take life so seriously. It's hard on others. You need to know what you know and know who you know and know where you're going and live life for the glory of God so that you can enjoy it. Someone said to me, "You don't worry about making people mad, do you?" I said, "No, I used to. Then if I worried that hard, it was hard on me. So I just worry about making God happy."
Amen.
Sometimes people get mad. They don't like it. They don't agree. That's the point. Sometimes they'll say, "You know, I'd come to your church, but you laugh too much." And I always respond, "Good. We don't want you to come because you'll ruin it." I don't know what you think you're going to do in heaven, but I have this suspicion that we're going to enjoy ourselves.
Amen.
And I just want you to do that. And if you ever get offended by something I say, let me give you some fatherly advice. You'll get over it. You'll get over it. You know, I'm not, some of this stuff, let me share a tremendous, this is not the preaching. This is the intro to the intro. Let me share something with you that's very valuable. a verse that's helped me. A lot of verses have helped me tremendously. A just man falleth seven times, riseth up again. That verse has helped me in my Christian life so much. The verse, a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. Some of you need medicine. This one has really helped me. Great peace have they which love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. We live in a day where everybody's offended. A lady was flying a flag in Florida. Blue lives matter. By the way, they do. Right, Jim? She was visibly expressing her support, those in her family, connected to law enforcement. Someone complained that that was offensive to the Black Lives Matter group. You know what I would say? Get over it. Get over it. Everybody's offended. You know what? If somebody doesn't live like I live, they're missing it. If they want me to live like them and they try to force me, I'll fight it. But if they don't like the way I, so what? So what? Don't be so touchy. I can remember Amy's dad would always tell his kids, don't be so sensitive. Don't be so sensitive. And man, that's true. We're too sensitive. Like we're looking for a fight. Like we're looking for something to be mad about or sour about. Not me, man. I'm looking for something to laugh about. And if you can laugh at me, laugh away. You won't offend me. And if I laugh at you, you're just going to have to get over it. Because if I have the opportunity to do it, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. 2 Timothy chapter 4. 2 Timothy chapter 4. There's a phrase I can't shake. 2 Timothy chapter 4. When I was a kid, I always blamed the fact that the principal knew me so well. Grade school. Well, in high school too. I skipped so much school in high school that the vice principal wanted to be my buddy and wanted to know why I missed so much school. And I said, it's not you. It's just this whole place. And when it's warm out, I'd rather be at the beach. So we would skip school and go to the beach. And in grade school, I just seemed to be magnetized to trouble. And they had a spot reserved on the steps in front of the principal's office for me. And it was a lady nun, and she would make you sit on the steps when you got in trouble. And when they switched classes, everybody walked by and see you sitting on the steps. And you knew that that person was in trouble. I'd sit on the steps, it's like a parade, all my buddies. And so they all go by, hey. And I remember they all went to class. She came down. She goes, this is not supposed to be fun. Well, number one, it's a marble step. That was bad. I thought that was punishment enough, sitting on that hard step. And then I'm seeing my friends. And she said, this is not about you being friendly. This is about you. You're in trouble. When I got saved, I realized that there had to be, we call it, the world doesn't know what it is maybe, or those who don't know Christ as their own Savior, but you and I would call it, if we're born again, we would call it peace. Peace, great peace. It doesn't mean we always laugh, but it means we do always have great peace. Everything's not laughable, but in every situation, because we believe and know God's in control, we can have great peace. 2 Timothy chapter 4. Let me read, if you'll allow me. If you won't allow me, I'll pay you. But verse 1. See, when I do that, some of you just are, you're so like heavens. You just don't know how to take that. You need to quit being so touchy and sensitive. Just relax, and the Lord will speak to you, and he'll use even me. Verse 1, 2 Timothy 4, verse 1. I charge thee, therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Note that, verse 1. Who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom? So Paul is writing to a young preacher by the name of Timothy, and Paul is encouraging him and telling him, verse 2, to preach the word. It, that means more than get the Bible out and preach. It means to concentrate on that. Focus on that. Make that your life. If you're a preacher, that's your life. Make that your life. Your boss wants you to concentrate on your job. The only thing when I was in Tool and Die, you've got to pay attention. Them big cutters will get away on you. You got to kind of watch them grinders and bits, those cutting tools. You know, when I was in it, now you don't have to touch anything. It's all lazy man's work. But we had to crank knobs, you know, and read them numbers on the dials, and it had to be just right, and then put a little indicator and make sure everything was right on. And that metal doesn't grow back. My dad always says it's never a bad haircut. It's just a too short haircut. But it always grows back, his mistakes. My dad would always say, my mistakes always grow back. And metal doesn't grow back. And we had some of you at John and maybe someone else remembers when we first got here, there's a man by the name of Hervey McGowan. And if you came in and he ever met you, he'd say, hello, and he'd kind of wobble his head. And he'd say, my name's Hervey, I have all my fingers. And I didn't know that's just the way he greeted people. Hi, I'm Hervey, I have all my fingers. Because he was a carpenter. And I guess you're kind of glad when you retire and you have all your fingers. So he would make sure that everybody that came here knew that he was around high-powered tools and he never cut his fingers off. Because as far as I know, fingers don't grow back. So there's some things you can make a mistake with, but there's some things you can't. Paul wants Timothy to major on that which is important. And he tells in verse 2, preach the word. Be instant, in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time, verse 3, he says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they, verse 4, they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. Verse 6, very important, verse 6. He said, for I am now ready to be offered. Offered there, verse 6, is the same word as sacrifice. He said, I am ready to be a sacrifice. If God wants to drain my blood, throw me on an altar and light the altar and burn me, and that will please him, Paul said, that's what I want. That's what I want. He said, I am now. And he didn't mean that like I've lived my life, done everything I want to do. I'm happy. Man, I got away with it. No, he said, that's how I've lived, for I am now ready. And it's constructed in a way that it means that's what he always did and it always worked. So he'll keep doing that even till the day that he's not here anymore, but he's with the Lord. Verse 6, he said, "For I am now ready to be a sacrifice, to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand." So he was ready to leave because he was always doing the right thing. Nobody had to keep telling him, "Hey, you better live right. Hey, you better watch it." Verse 7. He tells us what he did. He said, "I fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I've kept the faith." Verse 8. He said, "Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing." Appearing, watch now, verse 8. The word appearing is the word epiphany. We get our word epiphany from that, and it means to make visible. So Paul knew that there would be a day. He had served all those years, suffered shipwreck, been attacked, been beaten, been whipped, went to jail, spent most of his Christian life in the pokey, in the clink, in the brig, in the big house. Some of you don't have a clue, do you? That's jail. All those years he spent for God in jail, in prison. And he did all of that, endured all of that, would do it again. And he never saw Christ. Hey, some of you people that brag. I told Jeremy, I said, "Hey, this baby dedication is going to cost you." He said, I'll pay. I said, "I don't want money. I want food." He said, "We're cleaning out our freezer. We're trying to get rid of food." You women that brag about what a good cook you are and some special dessert you make, make it appear. Give me an epiphany. "Oh, you know what I make?" No, I don't know what you can make, because I can't taste it with my eyes. I want to taste it. Listen to me. Paul is saying, "I've read the recipe. I've looked at the pictures." My wife will tell you, on my phone, my grandkids will tell you, my phone is full of pictures of food. We went to eat Friday, and I'm clipping, you know, pictures of the food. And it's funny how the waitresses see, you go by and I'm taking pictures of the food and they kind of go. I mean, I'm going to eat it too. But Paul said, all these years I've read the recipe. All these years I have looked at the pictures of the food, if you will. He said, "But I know," verse 8, he said, "I know the day's coming when all I've done, all I've said, all I've preached will become a reality, will become an epiphany, an appearing. It will all appear. It will all become visible." And that's what I want you to think about tonight. I want you to think about the fact that Paul said you and I ought to live in a way where we want Jesus to come. When I was young, my cousins lived two doors away. And I would sleep over there just because. And the goal was not to sleep. The goal was to stay up as late as we could. You won't appreciate this. He looks like a swell guy on TV. But if you've seen the commercials for Pasquale's or Rulli's restaurant, and Sam was one of the cousins I was sleeping over with, and his dad will be on their white hair, and he looks like just a sweet Italian guy. He had this bull whip. You know what a bull whip is? They whip the bulls in Italy with it. They took a big rope and they twisted it. They doubled it and they twisted it together and put a big leather grip on it. And we'd be in their bedroom just laughing, talking. And pretty soon we'd hear this, "Hey! I'm gonna come into there." We'd be quiet. We'd laugh. Then pretty soon we'd start yakking again. Laughing. Man, I mean, it was middle of the night. It must have been 11 o'clock. For him, he gets up at 4 to go to work, work at Bendix. And we're just laughing. And pretty soon you'd hear this, "Hey! I'm a no kidding." That's Italian. If you don't get this, I'll translate it for you. "I'm a no kidding. I'll come into there." And the doors were closed and we could hear him. Calm down a minute. Pretty soon we'd start laughing again. Then that door, boom, would bust open. "Why, I tell you," he'd say, "Vito, you go home." It's the middle of the night, 11:30. My parents are asleep. They don't want me. That's why they ship me here. He said, "You be quiet." When Amy and I dated, Pasquale wasn't there. When Amy and I dated, we'd sit on the couch. Her curfew was midnight. She had to be home. I had to be gone. Her mom and dad are in bed. Her dad got up real early. We're sitting on the couch in the living room. Madly in love. She was madly in love. We'd stare at each other. We didn't even say anything. We just stared at each other. Pretty soon midnight would come. This voice from upstairs would go, "Amy, time to go to bed." She'd go away. We'd stare at each other. Pretty soon the voice would say, "Amy," her mom, "Amy, tell Vito it's time to go." She'd go away. We'd stare at each other some more. The voice said, "Vito, you need to go." So we'd stare at each other, and pretty soon Amy would go, "The next voice you're about to hear is my dad. You probably should be gone." So I would finally get, "Hey, you remember that terror, don't you? We were late one time. We popped open the door, the front door. We snuck in because we knew we were late. We came in the front door. He was sitting on the piano bench right here. So when we opened the door, we walked right into him. He had his pants on, didn't have any socks on, didn't have a shirt on. I found out later that that means he got out of bed. And he came down and he waited for us to come down, come home. So when he opened that door, he positioned that piano bench so that when we opened the door, we couldn't go anywhere but confront him." I'll tell you what, that was one of the scariest nights of my life. He stood on that bench, no shirt, just his work pants, no socks, like this. He said, "You're late." I'm hoping he would look at Amy. He looks at me. He goes, "You're late. Where were you?" "We had a flat tire." I wouldn't believe that if I were you. But we did. And you don't tell him that after he's up now sitting on a bench. That ain't going to work. He goes, "Where were you?" I said, we had a flat tire. "Did you?" I wanted to say, "Can I go to the bathroom?" He said, "You're not going to be late again." I said, "Nope." He said, "In fact, you're going to take her earlier, aren't you?" So she'll be home on time. She'll never be late again, will she? Flat tire, whatever. You, never, right? I said, never. He said, I don't care if you leave early, but I care if you're late. You're late. She's not going to be late, is she? I said, no, sir. And he wouldn't move. I figured he'd get up, go upstairs, and then we could stare at each other. He sat there. He said, say goodnight. Do you want Jesus to come? Do you really want to face him? There was a day, Paul tells us here, that he looked forward to more than any other day. Because of the way he lived, that day to him was not fearful. But he knew that day that when he would meet the Lord face to face was the day that he had, as he told us, he had fought his fight and finished his course and kept the faith. Let me tell you what he did. Every day he checked his direction. Every day he made sure that he was heading in the right direction. He wanted to be sure that he uses the word, verse 7, he uses the word course. Every day he wanted to be sure that he was on the right course. You can't check it once in a while. You have to check it every day. Because if you get off course 2 days, it's a longer way back. And Paul didn't want to do that. And that's just plain, good, common sense. That if you get out of your way a little bit, then turn around as quick as you can. If you wait, just put it off, then it's a long trip back. And that just gets hard. And so Paul told the Corinthians in 1 Corinthians 9, he said, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest that by any means, when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. He begins that verse by saying, but I keep under my body. And that means he continually inspected where he was, what he was doing. Am I doing the right thing? Am I thinking right? Am I headed in the right direction? He made sure, in a sense, like Jesus said, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross daily, and follow me. So what Paul is saying there is that he made sure that every day he crucified his body. Let me tell you something. That's hard. I eat a lot of junk. I don't not eat what I want. I'm going to eat what is really good for you. You're not my mother. I eat what I want, but I don't eat a lot of it. Some people go, I don't know how you do that. I'll tell you the truth, I don't know either. Because if I drank booze, man, I would be the biggest alcoholic you know. Do you understand? Paul didn't know how he would die. He didn't know when he would die. So he made sure daily that he was on the right course. I met Ivan. I saw Terry Harris this week. Terry and Nancy, you know Terry the Indian. And I said, Terry, how you doing? How's everything going? He said, man, my mother died. My son had a stroke. And I had surgery. I said, well, no wonder we haven't seen you. 54 years old, his son, 54 years old, had a massive stroke. Look at me. 54 is young. To some of you, it isn't. To some of me, it is. That's young. And Paul felt that way. He didn't know how he would die. He didn't know when he would die. So he made sure every day that he was on the right course. Can I ask you a question? Not about you. It's just a question that will make you think. Here's the question. The day that Paul did die, you think that was a sad day? I don't think so. Paul said, man, I am ready. Verse 8, he said, there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. You love the fact that he's going to be visible. You can face him. You've done what you should do. He knew, Paul knew at the end of his life that he had finished his course. He knew his purpose. 2 points. Here we go. Going to finish quick. Here we go. Here we go. Number one. You and I need to live life on purpose. Have a purpose. Why are you here? I mean, get something to do. You say, oh, I just got a dumb job. Hey, that job, you're in that job because there's someone that God wants to minister to through you. Whatever you do, if you're a button pusher, let's say you're a professional button pusher. You've been to school for button pushing. You've taken all, you've got your master's degree in button pushing. Pushing, not pushing, pushing. Right, Doug? you are the training instructor for button pushing. You say, well, really, anybody can do this job? Yeah, but God put you there for a reason. There's a purpose. It's not about what you do. It's about you doing what God wants you to do. You remember God stopped Paul on the Damascus Road and told him to follow him. He knocked Paul off his donkey. He said, hey, your life has changed. Your purpose has changed. Not about you anymore. Not about what you do. It's about me. God has a course for your life. There's a reason why you're alive. John the Baptist finished his course. He pointed people to Jesus Christ. Moses finished his course. He led the children of Israel out of Egypt and into the promised land. And even before you were born, God had a course for your life. And I'll tell you something. I've learned it. I've heard it repeatedly over 35 years. You can't be happy unless you're on that course. You get off that course, you will get happy. You get frustrated. You'll try different things. So what you got to do is just live life on purpose. Get on that course. And God will take care of your happiness. Number two, 2 points, I'm done. Look, stay with me. Number one, live life on purpose. Number two, stay on course. Stay on course. I was thinking back about many, many, many of the guys I went to college with. Good, godly, powerful men. Man, I heard about a lot of them got saved. They went through Bible college. And I'm hearing these stories about they weren't really saved. Many, so many, many of them are divorced. Living with women. One guy who I never thought could get a wife in the first place. I went to check up on him and they said, you didn't hear? He's living with three women. I mean, that puzzled me because it was three women, and it puzzled me because it was him. Man, this guy was brilliant. Men that challenged me, men that helped me, men that grabbed me aside. I'm talking about in college, men, married men, older married men that helped school me in school, with school, and apart from school, just to be a blessing to me. They left their wives. They ran off with some woman. Many, many, I check on these guys. They're burned out. They're not pastoring anymore. It's easy to get off course. I try to stay on course every day. Every day I check my spiritual direction. Every day I pray, Lord, don't let me get off course. I have to check my progress and my direction every day. I have to make sure that I'm pointed in the direction that God wants me to go. And that gets burdensome. That gets hard. So it's easier just to float away. It's easier to wander or stray. Everything that we do needs to center around our course. You can be off course by a tiny bit, but if you stay off course just a tiny bit, you'll be way off course. Paul tells Timothy, I've stayed on course. And he encouraged him to stay on course. He looked at his purpose. He knew that he would meet Jesus someday. Verse 8, he knew that he would be rewarded. He said, there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness. He knew that that crown was there, but it was only there if he stayed on course. He knew that that crown was there. He knew that Jesus was coming back or he would die and Jesus would be visible to him. So he knew that what he had to do was keep his purpose clear, keep his direction clear. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2 says, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus is our purpose. Listen to what I'm about to say. I am not what I ought to be, but I look to Jesus every day. You can't live the Christian life once a week. You got to live it every day. In order for it to be successful, in order for other people to go, wow, you can't live it when you feel like it. You can't live it when it's convenient. You have to purpose at it. I'm not perfect. My wife knows, but God knows better. I'm stubborn. My life's verse should be in Psalms where it says, be not as the horse or mule. I'm just like a mule. I'm just plain old. God knows that. I'm good at majoring on minors. Man, I'm good at making a big deal out of little stuff. And God knows that. I have faults, and I hate them. So I've got to keep on course. Someday I want to be able to say, someday, if I check myself every day, someday I want to be able to say I've finished my course. I'm not thinking about first place. I'm thinking about finishing. If I run as hard as I can, I want to finish. I want to do what God wants me to do. Paul writes to the church in the book of Acts. He says, none of these things, Acts 20, 24. He said, but none of these things move me, neither count I my life dear unto myself, so that I might finish my course with joy. And the ministry which I've received of the Lord Jesus to testify the gospel of the grace of God. You might be here tonight and you know you're off course. You promised God you'd serve him. You made some decision. You made some promise. But now you're off course. And you know what happens? It gets easy to stay off course if you don't get back on. How many times have I heard this? Pastor, I'd be in church, but man, I missed that one time and it got easier to miss. Look, there was a time in my life when I went through that. My pastor, I loved to death to do anything for him. I prayed so hard for him. We're fine now. But there was a time when he and I came to a point of contention. And I left his church, and man, I had a hard time going. And I'm ashamed to say that my kids would say, we going to church, and we wouldn't go to church. I was so mad and bitter and burned out, we'd drive around in a car on Sunday morning. I sat under some of the finest preaching, I believe, in the world. And I had to go to chapel every day, and we served in a church in Milwaukee on Sundays and Wednesdays, and they had hot, red hot preaching in chapel every day. I knew better. Well, I'll tell you what, you get knocked off course just a touch. You're heading in a direction you never thought you would. You know what happened to Paul? He had his head chopped off. Paul knew, listen to me, Paul knew at that moment, the moment they laid his head on that big tree stump and the executioner lowered that axe to sever his head from his body, Paul knew he finished his course. And he was ready for Jesus to be visible. If I can say that, that'll be enough. You need to find your course. You need to stay on it. And you need to finish it. Find your course. Stay on it. And finish it. Your head bowed, your eyes closed. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Our dear Lord, thank you that you would choose us to serve you. Thank you that there's something we can do for you. Doesn't seem like there would be anything that we could do that would amount to anything for you. Thank you that you've given us the truth. Thank you that we have a word that you call good news. You said we ought to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. We have a job to do. We have a purpose. You left us here because there's someone that needs to hear that Jesus Christ died for their sins and rose from the dead. You said that's why we're here. Paul said, I've done that. I've finished that. And I am ready. I'm loving the fact I'm going to see Jesus. May you speak into the heart of every one of us that we would know truly, as Paul said, what it means to love. To love the fact that Jesus will become visible, whether he comes back and raptures us or we die and stand before him. Paul said, I am loving the fact that I'm going to meet him finally. I've been talking about him. I've been preaching about him. I even lost my head over him. Lord, may we be able, like Paul, to find our course, to stay on it, to finish it. Your head bowed, your eyes closed. You say, preacher, God is speaking to me. I need to find my course. I need to stay on it. I need to finish it. Your head bowed, your eyes closed. You say, preacher, you pray for me. God speak to my heart. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. Others, preacher, God speak to my heart. Thank you, thank you. Many of you, preacher, God is speaking to my heart. God is speaking to my heart. I want to be able to love his appearing. He's going to come back. Some of you are going to go, oh no. Oh no, he's here. Oh no, I died and I'm not ready. I mean, you'll be with him maybe, but you need to be ready. You need to know you're going to be ready. Last call. Preacher, I haven't raised my hand yet, but here's my hand. God is speaking to my heart. If that's you and you haven't raised it, real quick, heads bowed, eyes closed. Preacher, will you pray for me? Will you pray for me? Our Father, may you bless this time. May you make it easy for us to get on our course and stay there and finish. I pray this in Jesus' name. Here's what we're going to have you do. The piano will play. You're going to stand. Would you stand? Give you just a minute. You may need to make a decision there. You may need to make a decision up here. We want you to have the opportunity to do that. I don't want to push you and present something to you and then you don't get an opportunity to do something about it. God is speaking to your heart. If God is speaking to your heart as the piano plays, you're standing. If God's speaking to your heart, we want to give you the opportunity to do what you know you need to do. This is about you tonight. God is speaking to your heart. She's playing. We won't give you long. Come on. If you're going to come, come on now as she plays. God's speaking to your heart. You know it. You know it. Here's, come on. This verse. I'm going to pray. Lord, we ask that we'll be very careful to live life on purpose. Not just, yeah, we're here. Yeah, I'm not sure what to do. You have a purpose for us and help us to stay on the course. Bless this night. Thank you for the opportunity to gather around and pray for each other. And tonight we're asking you to make this a special moment for Jeremy and Lisa. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You be seated, would you please? One of the greatest things I think we could do is raise children, to pray with them. I'm going to just give you a little quick baby dedication. Aaron's not a baby anymore. I mean, he is, but he isn't. So let me give you a little talky talk. That's like honky tonk, but talky talk. Some of us that are parents, we've watched our kids grow up. We've prayed over them. When they were throwing up, that's a woman's job. They're sick. They got their shots. How could that mean old doctor stick them with that 2-foot needle? They did bad. They did wrong. They broke stuff. And that little baby who we never thought would make us mad has now become a terror. How important. We had 4. They're all different. The women are really different. God is being very good to Jeremy and Lisa because they don't have any women. Women are hard. Sorry. I don't know what you want to hear. I'm not going to soft soap it. My boys, I'd say bend over. They'd go, okay. I'd say that to the girl. She turned into the devil. Wow. Done this 3 times. I'm on my 4th, and she just give me, hey, it's their makeup. And the problem is she's like her dad. You can raise them right, but they respond differently. God gave, let's just talk about Aaron. God gave you Aaron. Boy, we prayed hard. Remember Kuzma's house? Boy, at least we just prayed, she had a baby. And Caleb came along like, wow. I didn't want to go through that again, praying for another one. We prayed. Here's Aaron. You know what? All God cares about, he knows what, he wouldn't give them to if he didn't think you could handle it. All he cares about is that you raise them so he looks good. You know, you say, oh, raise your kids like God. I got news for you. You're not God. And when you have kids and you come home and the three boys have dug a swimming pool in the front yard and used all the trash bags to line it so they could fill it with water, you don't feel very godlike. Then you look back and think, man, I would take those problems in a minute. You can fill in holes. You can steal trash bags. Or I mean buy. Luke chapter 2, Jesus is born. They circumcise him. And it's interesting, Luke chapter 2, verse 21 and 22, it says, and when 8 days were accomplished for the circumcision of the child, his name was called Jesus, which was so named of the angel before he was conceived in the womb. It says, and when the days of her purification, according to the law of Moses, were accomplished, Mary and Joseph brought Jesus to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. And I read that again. So the Lord was brought to the Lord. Joseph and Mary had this little baby. It's Jesus. They knew it before he was born. It was a virgin birth. And so now they take him to the temple. Not because he needed it. He was baptized. Not because he needed it. But to give us a pattern. God wants your kids. He gave them to you. He wants you to give them back. Parenting's big stuff. And that's why I think they show us what you're about to do tonight. You all need to think about this. If you don't have kids yet, you need to think about this. Here's what's happening. They are saying tonight, Jeremy and Lisa are saying, God gave us this child. And we say, you know, I'm not going to debate with you. We've got to give him back to God. God doesn't want him back. He wants you to raise him so he brings or she brings him glory. That's the whole point of this. God called us to raise our kids. God is going to do it here. So what Jeremy and Lisa are saying tonight, there's 400, but I jot down 3. They're saying tonight that they love God more than they love their child. Say, is that bad? Of course not. Of course not. That child belongs to God. And so they are giving themselves to do the best they can. The second thing they're saying tonight is that God owns their child. Children are a gift from God. Psalm 127, verse 3 says, lo, children are a heritage of the Lord. Heritage means a possession. So we're telling them, they already know it and they're learning, they'll learn more. But we're encouraging them to be careful with God's property. Yes, be careful with God's property. And number 3, this isn't a ceremony, this is a commitment. You see, it's hard to be a godly parent because your kids really know what you are. They're with you in the thickest, in the thinnest. They know you. Huh? We're driving down the street. Stephen yells out the window. Guy cut in front of me. Watch it, bozo! That was a couple weeks ago. I looked at Amy and I said, where did he learn that? Like hoping she would go, I use that all the time. I'm sorry. You know what she said? She goes like this. She didn't say anything. She goes. I said, I don't talk like that. I tell you what. You know what? do that anymore. God bless you. They come from me. God bless you. God bless you, Bozo. Or God bless you. They pick up on everything. When they learn how to read numbers, they know that the speed limit sign and the speedometer should match. Dad? Hard to have a cop in the family. He was a cop back then. Dad? You're supposed to be going 35? It's 55. Yes, son, that's for other people. That's for people who can't drive. I'm special. You need to pray for them. He's wound up, isn't he? We know, we've learned, I've seen it, I've talked to parents. We want them to be godly. We want them to teach Aaron and Caleb. We want them to teach them about Christ, keep them in church, love them, pray for them, train them, and make their home a holy place. Proverbs 22 and verse 6. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he's old, he won't depart from it. And tonight, Lisa and Jeremy are dedicating themselves to getting Aaron in the right path. So as he makes his journey through life, he'll have something that he can look back on. Train up a child the way he should go, and when he's old, he won't depart from it. You going to make it? You don't even have to stay. Just stay there. Want to pray with me, Caleb? I'm going to pray for Aaron. Okay? Ready? You don't want to pray? Ready, Aaron? We're going to pray. Not me. I was up there. Same guy. Ready? I'm going to hold his hand. I'm not going to hold him. That may not go over well. Thank you. He's grabbing on, boy. Hold on. Ready? I'm going to pray. Father, thank you for Jeremy and Lisa. Thank you for their testimony all these years. Thank you how they've been a blessing to people. And now you're going to use them to be a blessing to their own kids. I pray, God, give them everything they need. Give them the wisdom. Give them the strength. Give them the patience. Give them everything that it's going to take so that Aaron gets everything that you want him to have. Thank you for this precious gift. He truly is a gift, Lord, as is Caleb. And I pray that you'll bless their home. Help them, God, as they build an actual physical home. Meet every need that they have. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. They always cry when it's time to... Oh, quit now. Okay, we're done. You can go.